Wherever you are on the spectrum from burned out to fully charged can be determined by whether you have a net gain or a net drain of energy on a physical, mental, emotional, social, and spiritual level. Stress, emotional trauma, words thrown around a lot. And I want people to really understand that sometimes it's like some big milestone that happens for you. And sometimes it's that you're the fourth child and nobody's making a baby album for you. And you realize that it doesn't seem like people care, right? But it's not that they don't care.
So our guest, Neha Sangwan, she's an MD, CEO, and founder of Intuitive Intelligence, and she empowers individuals, leaders, and teams with effective communication skills that address stress, prevent burnout, inspire accountability, and empower collaboration. And she consults for top organizations like Google, Amex, Kaiser Permanente, and the American Heart Association. And she has shared her work across three TED stages and authored a couple books we're going to talk about today, Talk RX and also Powered by Me, which is her new book that's out. And you can learn more about her work, do a deeper dive at intuitiveintel.com. Neha, welcome to the show.
Excited to be here.
Yeah, so why don't you tell us a little bit about your background and kind of why you're doing the work you are today?
So let's just talk about how far back I should go here. But I'm the middle daughter of immigrants that came to the U.S. after an arranged marriage in 1965. I grew up in Michigan, and I spent a few of my young years with my grandparents. They were stationed in the United Nations out in Africa. So I went there 3 months, came back at 2 years. The reason that's important is because it sets the stage for everything that comes next. Which is my devastation around leaving my grandparents and, not really fitting in my own family because I was 2 years old before I ever got there, really. And so a little bullying happening, all sorts of things. And so what I did was I became, like many people, I became a master of the external world. I was going to know what everybody in the room needed from me. I was going to give them whatever they needed from me so that hopefully no one would send me away again. Of course, I didn't understand this at the time. At the time, I was just a little kid trying to survive and make things happen. But I grew up and realized that athletics and academics is what my community, my parents, my grandparents, everybody wanted from me and what would get me accolades. So I'm a biomedical and mechanical engineer. I went on to get an internal medicine, become an internal medicine physician. I burned out when I was 34 years old. And for the last 20 years, have made it my passion and my job to heal myself and help the world demystify this thing, this global overwhelm we're feeling, really kind of personalize it to each person, because how each person gets there is unique as their fingerprint, and then give powerful and practical tools to heal. And so in 2008, I left my partnership at the hospital. I was an internal medicine physician for many years, and I left and became an entrepreneur and, you know, speak and write and now transform stressful cultures into healing organizations.
Right. Yeah. And I love that you're a medical doctor and you're trying to teach people about burnout and stress. Because for me, when I'm working with people, one of the biggest roadblocks to healing is because they're so stressed out, or their response to their circumstances, or their emotional trauma, that fear of abandonment, that perfectionism and other things that propel them to eventually become burned out. And so let's kind of break those things down. So can you talk about that emotional trauma component? You said the fear of abandonment. You know, I had, you know, trying to get my father's approval, doing that through academics as well. And that people pleasing, it's so annoying. And, you know, now I have this personal mantra, like my needs are just as important as other people, if not more important, you know, and just, you know, you feel guilty. You can feel guilty about focusing on yourself.
Yeah. So I would say let's start with, stress causes or exacerbates more than 80% of all illness. So if stress causes or exacerbates more than 80% of all illness, why are we not asking people what's at the root of their stress? And I think it's that whole idea that it you know, our lives are so different and complex, and how are we going to find a common way? Well, what I do is I say, wherever you are on the spectrum from burned out to fully charged can be determined by whether you have a net gain or a net drain of energy on a physical, mental, emotional, social, and spiritual level. You mentioned stress and trauma and emotional trauma when you're young. And I really want that word's thrown around a lot. And I want people to really understand that sometimes it's like some big milestone that happens for you. You know, someone's physically abused, sexually abused, they get in a car accident. I don't know what it is. It could be lots of things. And sometimes it's that you're the fourth child and nobody's making a baby album for you and nobody's paying attention because they've already been through three other, you know, experiences like yours. So you just might start walking and nobody's clapping for you. And you realize that it doesn't seem like people care. Right. But it's not that they don't care. They got three other people running around that they care a lot. It's just that there's too much. Right. And so it's this perceived helplessness that causes trauma. If some of our needs don't get met, that can feel traumatic to someone. And so I want people to understand that just like burnout is from burned out to fully charged, so too can trauma be like this catastrophic thing, or it can be this feeling alone and not having your needs met, and it can be anything in the middle. And so there's not like, oh, my trauma doesn't matter because other people's. No, each of us has our own, it's like a soul blueprint. It's like our own life school that we have to go through that our soul is learning and growing from. And so none of them are more or less important. Some of them are more or less obvious. Some of them are more visible and others less visible. But they all shape how we show up today and how resourceful, how resilient, how able we are to live in a world that's moving faster than our biology can handle. So I'd start there, like the true understanding of there's nobody that escaped this. There's people who are better at suppressing it than others. But emotional disappointments, like I think we're in a world that doesn't teach us to handle disappointment. We deflect it on others. We act like it didn't happen. But very few people say like, okay, let me feel this. Let me reveal it, feel it, and heal it. And let me use it to elevate myself. And I think that's where we're headed. I think the people, the companies that are going to excel are going to be the ones where you don't just do that for your leadership team. You do that for everybody. And that's the mental and emotional health crisis that we're in.
Yes. And yeah. And it's so important to be looking at your stressors because, I mean, in the research, we see that heart rate variability, which is a measure of stress, is a more important variable than your level of exercise, your diet, your cholesterol level, whether you smoke or not, whether you're overweight or not, all these things. It's the heart rate variability. It's the stress. That's really that you really need to be paying attention to and, you know, monitoring your heart rate variability too.
Yeah. And that's something that, you know, it's about how flexible is your heart? Can it adjust? It's really the name of the game is agility, right? It's how able are you to handle the unknown and stressors? We all went through a pandemic a few years ago. And the idea there is for some people, it was like, oh, all right, like, looks like I'm going to need to shift how I'm doing this and I'm going to, and they moved into it quite easily. Other people were like, thank God I don't have to be around people. And then other people were like, oh no, like losing the control of, you know, the ways, the routines, the ways they functioned, that kind of forced change, I think is a glimpse of with AI and other things coming, how fast the world is going to be changing. Like this is right here, right now, is the slowest the world is going to be for the rest of our life. And so how well we learn to, and you're right, markers like heart rate variability show that agility of your own physiology. And these are markers that's in your body. And then there's the emotional agility. Do you take risks? Are you able to handle disappointment or do you protect yourself? And if you protect yourself from disappointment, devastation, heartbreak, whatever it is, I want you to know that you're also limiting the amount of joy you can feel. So you aren't just limiting and protecting yourself from the hard, uncomfortable emotions. You're also probably going to be wondering in a short amount of time, where did all my joy go? Because that gets limited too.
Yes.
So we're living in a very complicated world, and I think it's really important for us to remain as lifelong learners, for us to grow and learn from each other, to admit when we don't know, to be agile, not only measured by your heart rate variability, but really kind of, I almost, my wish for people is do one thing that scares you each day. You know, build your own self-trust. Make one agreement with yourself and keep it. It can be as simple as, I'm going to get in bed by 10 o'clock, I'm going to read, and then I'm going to be, go to bed by 11. And just make that agreement and keep it. And now all of a sudden you have a little more self-trust. You believe yourself. You know, and if you keep doing that, you will, and then the other one, if you want to, you know, take it to another level, you do one thing that's stretching yourself, that's outside your comfort zone. That will also build self-trust.
Yes. Yeah. And I know that a lot of people can feel stress and anxiety just because they don't deal well with uncertainty, or they don't want to be out of their routine or out of their job they've had for 10 years or whatever. But if you can, you know, learn to cope with uncertainty and accept it, and then also learn to be more flexible, I think that goes a long way to reducing stress. Easier said than done. But so what are some of your tips for people to avoid burnout or to deal with that? Because I think it's really hard for people to say no. They take on too many things. They feel obligated to their family or their kids. And there's just, it's hard to say no and just slow down.
Yeah. Well, here's what I'll say is, when you're saying yes to something, you're saying no to everything else. So anybody listening to our podcast right now, you're saying yes to this and you're saying no to whatever else could be going on. So we're always saying no to something. The question is, when you're saying no to someone else, get really clear on what you're saying yes to. Because you might be, let's say someone says, hey, could you take my weekend shift? And you say, you know what? I think this weekend I'm going to say yes to a good night's sleep. That's what you're saying yes to. So I think this no yes flip is really important. And let's dial it back. So now when I was saying in burnout, right? Burnout is where you are from burned out to fully charged, is whether you have a net gain or a net drain of energy on a physical, mental, emotional, social, spiritual. We're on social right now because you're navigating yourself and others. I'm going to talk about that for a minute, and then I think it would probably be good. We'll just run through them so that people can have an idea. And I'm happy also to give you the awareness prescription for burnout, if that's something you want to put in the show notes and give your listeners. But essentially what we're doing here is, there's this, you know how you were speaking about moving into uncertainty, there's structure and routine, which has value, and then there's flexibility. So you're holding a paradox. That holds true for many things, because too much of anything becomes a weakness. Too little of anything becomes a weakness. So as sexy as it is to be amazing at anything, true balance is what keeps you from being burned out. So it's like Mother Nature has figured this out. It's like exert your body and then rest, right? Why is one third of our life spent sleeping? That's our rest. So with people, there's this choice that really isn't a choice in the world for children. And it's, do you show up as who you are and start crying when you're unhappy and tell people and express yourself, you know, loudly sometimes in public? Or do you behave in a way that maintains your attachment to the people who care for you? So it's authenticity versus attachment. And for a child, it's not fair because they don't really have a choice. They must choose attachment over authenticity. There's a way to behave in society, and we learn it young. You want to get a smile. You want to get the things you need from your parents and your caretakers and the people around you. Well, then you suppress the authenticity and you focus on the attachment. And that's what you and I were talking about, like athletics, academics, what's going to make them happy. And we start playing this game, which is, who do you want me to be? I'll be it, you know? So that's the social section. And what I'd say there is, if you want to know whether you're having a net drain or a net gain in the social energy section, this is how you do a pulse check. Write down the five people or groups of people that you spend the most time with in person or online. And as you're writing that, okay, that's using your mind, you're writing that down, pay attention to your body, because sometimes our mind and our body are not in alignment. And is your body, as you're writing these names down, constricting, heavy, tight, or is it open, relaxed, and light? So if I'm writing someone's name down and I'm like, oh, my heart starts racing or my stomach starts turning or whatever's going on there, that gets a net drain of energy. And you do that for five of them. And then you look at all five and you see what you've written. And then underneath, you check overall social energy, net gain or net drain. So that's social. Let's jump back up and let's do physical, mental, emotional, and spiritual. Okay. So physical, the question I ask you there is, if you could give yourself a rating between 1 to 10 on how satisfied you are by how well you nourish yourself, do you sleep 7 to 9 hours of not only quantity of sleep, but quality, meaning do you wake up in the morning feeling rested? Do you have fun and joyful ways to move your body multiple times a week? And do you have an even energy throughout the day? Or are you someone who's, you know, famished and the first time you realize it is 2 p.m. when your stomach's growling and then you eat something and then you have an energy dip? And like, where are you in the energy? How steady is your energy? So once people do that, then it's about, okay, if there's anything that was less than a 10 for you, what would make it a 10? And right there, you've got your plan on the physical level. Now, there's also physical symptoms, like people have joint pain, back pain, like anything that they might be struggling with, knee pain, they had an injury, like whatever it is. So you also want to take assessment of your on your physical level, like, hey, is there anything that kind of bugs you that is kind of draining you of energy? And then you do the same thing. Overall, look at your answers and then check in with your body. I call it your body map. And it's like, hey, do I feel tight, heavy, constricted as I'm doing this? Or do I feel open, relaxed, and at ease? Overall, are you having a net gain or a net drain of energy on a physical level? So you're kind of seeing, like, what I want to do is, I know that everybody at certain times in their life are going to have different areas that are going to be gains and drains and all of that. And I wanted to really give people a way to do a pulse check, not just from here, because your mind sometimes can say, oh, who needs sleep? I have too much to do. Like, I'm not going to waste time sleeping. So for all of you out there that think like sleep is a waste of time, I'm going to say you're right. If what you're talking about is what's not getting done on your external to-do list, but your internal to-do list in your body needs that sleep. And that is memory consolidation, physical repair of your immune system, rebuilding your muscles if you've worked out, and emotional processing. So you don't have good sleep for a few days, you'll be the one who catches the cold right after that, and it'll force you into bed. So all of these pieces, you know, it took me 20 years to say, all right, if we don't know how to do this as doctors and we don't really have a plan to help people figure out how they got here, we need to build one because people expect us to be helping them figure this out. And so that's when I wrote Powered by Me.
Yes. And you also, when you go to your doctor, you aren't really getting any advice on how to reduce stress. And people say,
no.
Eat, eat better, you know, exercise, what do I do there? You know, it's because that's so individual. And so people are like, we need to reduce your stress. But yeah, I know that. But you're not really getting any concrete answers. So we talked about the physical, we talked about the social. Let's go to the mental next.
Yeah, mental. So mental is really about your thought patterns. So when things don't go as planned, do you blame yourself? Do you blame other people? Do you tend to think it's something bigger than you or them? So that's personalization, projection, and generalization. And so we often, like, because I was a little girl, sent away, came back, I couldn't blame the caretakers I was with, so I blamed myself. I wonder what I did that had people send me away. So I became, personalization became my default way of being. But you can imagine that when I'm blaming things on myself, that can be a big drain of energy. Now, our world and politics and everything that's going on is all about it's your fault, right? And so we have this projection way of thinking. Or some people want to avoid conflict altogether, and they're like, oh, I wonder if the plane landed okay. I hope the weather was okay. I hope they didn't get in an accident, and they make it bigger than me or you, and then nobody has to be blamed. That's generalization. The truth is, most situations have a component of every single one of those in them. There's something I did, there's something the other person did, and there's something in the environment that changed. So when you start to understand your thought patterns, it's really helpful. So one of the things I do in the mental energy section is, you have 70,000 thoughts per day. And 90 to 95% of those are the same as yesterday. That's a little depressing. But in that space, why would anyone change what they're thinking unless there's a crisis, unless something unexpected happens, right? So what you want to do is you want to pay attention to the thoughts that are running on autopilot in your mind. Write down three of them that you have on repeat when you're in the shower, when you're on your commute, when you're waking up in the middle of the night or first thing in the morning. Like, what's going on in the background of your mind? Almost like your playlist that would be on repeat. Like, what's that? And write those down. And are those thoughts that give you energy, or are they thoughts that drain you of energy? Are you someone who sees the world optimistically or skeptically? Where are you on that spectrum? And there's not a right or a wrong, but you want to understand why that is. So there's questions people need to ask themselves to become aware of, to understand why they're showing up in the world the way they are. And if they're undermining their own thoughts, when somebody has a differing opinion than you, do you double down, dig in, and say you're right? Or do you get curious, not furious? Like, who are you in that moment? These are some of the questions that will help you understand whether your mental energy is a net gain or a net drain. And then overall, look at it again and just kind of do a little body map inventory. Am I having constriction, you know, tenseness, heaviness? Am I open, light, you know, and at ease? And then give yourself an overall mental energy net gain or net drain. Emotionally is really easy. So let's move to emotional energy. I can figure that out so quickly because this is all I got to ask you. Tell me where in your life you're avoiding conflict or challenging emotions. Work, home, significant other, children, family, social life, like other, finances. You know, tell me where you're avoiding conflict or challenging emotion, and I'll tell you where emotional energy is getting drained.
Because it seems like that authenticity that you can find in your life is having those uncomfortable conversations and getting into alignment with what you should be in alignment with. And it starts with, you know, having those hard conversations with people, things you're avoiding.
So I wrote an entire book on this, and it's called TalkRx, Talk Prescription. So TalkRx, 5 Steps to Honest Conversations That Create Connection, Health, and Happiness. And I link your physical health to your ability to communicate. That goes back to what we said earlier, which is 80%, like, stress causes or exacerbates more than 80% of all illness. What's at the root of people's stress? The inability to communicate with themselves and each other. They're not getting messages from themselves. They don't know what to do with their throat constricting or their back hurting or whatever it is. They don't know what to do with that. Or they don't feel like they can be authentic in their relationships with their work. They don't feel like they know what their purpose is. They feel left out, lost. They don't belong. You know, all these ways of us communicating with ourselves and each other. That was my first book. I published that in 2015. And, you know, I have it on audiobook. I got the rights back from the publisher after 7 years, and I haven't put it in print again. But I have it. It's in audiobook. But that's an entire book on how do you get into inner alignment and how do you lead in the world from the inside out versus from the outside in. If you're leading from the outside in, what that means is your energy changes every room that you walk into. You're like driftwood in the ocean, going whichever way the wind's blowing, versus being a sailboat with a rudder, where the wind influences you, but you're charting your course. So you're taking in other people's feedback, but you're just not allowing it to dictate who you are. And I think that a lot of people are in the process right now of really learning that. So the other piece on the emotional energy where I would take inventory for them is, what areas of your life bring you play and joy? And now you're going to see where you have a net gain and where you have a net drain of emotional energy. And then we already did social, where you did the five people or groups of people you spend the most time with in person or online. And do they give you a net gain or drain of energy? And then lastly is spiritual. Spiritual energy. This is so interesting. People said to me, you wrote a business book. Why would you have included spiritual energy? And I say, because it's the most important energy of them all. Spiritual energy is about what matters to you. It's about your highest values. It's about why you spend the energy doing the things you do every day. This job, this relationship, this family, this city. Why did you pick these things? There's something that's really important to you, and you got to understand what that is. And those are your highest values, and that's your spiritual energy. For some people, they think of it as religion or faith or some, you know, I say that's more about like how you navigate mystery and awe, and that comes in spiritual energy too. But that's about how you navigate the unknown. How do you make sense of the unthinkable, of loss, of grief? Like, how do you do that? And so to me, it can be that. And, you know, one of the questions I ask is, tell me a time that you feel you felt really valued and appreciated. So if you can tell me what could someone say in a room about you that would mean so much to you? That will tell you what you value. Or if someone wants to just pick someone in the world that you admire, it can be someone you know, it can be a celebrity, it can be anyone. And then say the three things that you admire about them. Now you know what some of your highest values are. You can see them in other people, but those are also in you. And then there's about, you know, like we talked about the trust in the world that we're navigating a world of unknown and mystery and all of that. And so the name of the game is self-trust. How much do you trust yourself? Well, I ask you a couple of questions. I can find that out pretty easily. Tell me where you take risks and tell me where you don't take risks. So for me, I take risks mentally, emotionally, socially, spiritually, entrepreneurially, financially. I do not, until recently, I have not taken risks romantically in my life. And I would say that physically, I don't really take that many risks. Like, I'm not the one jumping out of an airplane or skydiving or scuba diving or like, not me. So now right away you can see, oh, that's where Neha trusts herself and that's where she doesn't. And so self-trust, highest values, feeling valued and appreciated, having a higher purpose. And what do you, when the whole world falls apart, what do you have faith in? What do you lean on to give you that strength as you walk into the mystery and the of the unknown? So to me, those kinds of questions will help you understand your spiritual energy, which is the foundation that fuels everything else.
Yeah, I love that because, I mean, for me, when I've, you know, I think with the whole pandemic, and I think part of that is a larger, big picture, a big spiritual battle that's going on in the planet. And then I found, you know, just gotten more in touch with my creator, and it gave me such a tremendous reduction in stress, kind of realizing that and connecting more spiritually and praying more and getting guidance in that way and trusting and kind of like surrendering to that was a huge stress relief and still is every day for me, and making that time for connecting with my creator. And so I think that's that, and I agree with you, that's the biggest component here. That's the most important component in stress reduction.
Yeah. And, you know, I kind of, what's helped me a lot is I've changed the way I look at failure, the way I look at mistakes, the way I look at missteps. And so what's helped me is I now think of this whole experience in life as life school. So it's like I'm a soul in a body on Earth, so I can play with, you know, interact with Earth, pick up data, and play with each other. Okay. My soul is here, and every experience, interaction, relationship is an opportunity for us to grow, learn, and heal, and to unite us. And so the real question is, do I trust myself, and do I trust others so that I will do that dance of having the authenticity, the honest conversations, the taking risks, and all of that to learn our life lessons together and grow? And if I do, then we can all evolve together as one world family. And as soon as I realized it wasn't like I had to conform to society's version of success, if I could understand what mattered to me, that my soul evolves, that I'm growing, that I'm taking risks, not that I'm looking perfect, not that I never make a mistake, because that means I'm in my comfort zone. I want to stretch. I want to make mistakes. I want to grow. I want to experience the adventure of life, and me growing and experiencing it is what makes me feel successful. And so I think redefining that, and, you know, I consider myself spiritual, and that idea of life school for my soul, and also having that grace for other people as they're navigating their own way, has really taken away the, I need to get an A, you know, I gotta, you know, figure out somebody else's measure of success and meet it. Because that didn't get me very far.
Yeah.
I mean, and listen, it got me far, but it didn't get me where I'm going.
Yeah, maybe it didn't buy happiness. But yeah. I agree. Like, looking at life as like a school and a growth opportunity, and, you know, looking at failure, like, quote, failures, like maybe that relationship didn't work out, or that project didn't work out, or having those hard conversations that, you know, you might be scared to detach from something if you have that conversation, but it's all going into alignment for what's in everyone's highest and best interests. And it's can be scary, but those things, they cause us to grow. They cause us to meet that next person that's going to be better for us, that next job that's going to be better for us, or whatever the case may be. But yeah, that takes away a lot of stress when you don't look as failures, or this relationship isn't the end all be all. There's always something better out there for you if, you know, you can kind of trust that everything's falling into an alignment for you. But you have to believe that also. You know, your thoughts and your mindset become your reality.
Yeah. And I think, you know, the way that I do it is when I lose money, let's say I'm an entrepreneur, right? So I did engineering, did medicine, then I started my own business. Well, I never got an MBA. I didn't do business school. So every time I lost money on something, like I made an investment or a decision and it didn't work out, what I say to myself is, okay, Neha, that's your MBA on the ground. Like, you just learned that lesson. And what did you need to learn from that? And the quicker you learn that lesson, the faster you are going to graduate from that lesson, and the less tuition you're going to have to pay for that lesson.
And so the question I tend to ask myself in a relationship or in a situation is, what do I have to learn here?
And as soon as I get the lesson, I know I won't repeat it again. And I think that's a really important thing because people will say, well, how do you have that mindset? Well, for me, it's, listen, what did I learn from that relationship? What did it give me? Why did I say yes? And what did I need to outgrow? Or like, I'll tell you, last year, there was, a funding of a major program that we've been running for 4 years, and it got pulled for this year. And so first I had a pit in my stomach, and I was like, oh my God, that's our largest funder. And then the next thought I had was, oh, I guess 25 CEOs at a time must not be big enough. We must be being moved into a space where we're going to have a larger impact. So I can view it as, oh my God, like there's not the security that there was. Or I can say to myself, oh, I wonder what the next level is. Because it's true. After 4 years, I kind of got comfortable there. And so it's almost like the universe is saying to me, okay, you learned what you came here to learn. Let's apply that, and it's time to stretch yourself, you know? And so I think sometimes we get to choose the wake-up call on our own, and if we don't, we get a little too comfortable, the universe kicks us in the butt a little bit.
Yeah. Or a lot.
Or a lot. Yeah.
But you always couldn't get back in the saddle. You don't have any choice.
Yeah. Yeah. And when you don't, it turns into things like you start coping with other things. It might become an addiction. It might become... That's when people start to falter, when they don't get back in the saddle or they lose belief in themselves, you know, when they don't have a support system around them to remind them of who they are. And I feel that that's why that whole spiritual and social is so important, because when I lose faith in me, because I will, I need to have surrounded myself with people in whose eyes I can look that will reflect that belief in me. You know, so I think the spiritual social is pretty remarkable, you know.
And so what advice do you give people who have kind of fallen off their path or not kind of living up to their standard or their vision for their life? So are people that have maybe fallen into addiction and they're in that dark space right now? What do you recommend to them?
So let's start. If physically, if you're struggling and you don't know where to turn, I would tell you a good resource is drhyman.com, drhyman.com. Dr. Mark Hyman and his 15, 18 books, I don't even know how many, they're solid, they're really good. He's the head of Cleveland Clinic's functional medicine practice. So drhyman.com, he wrote the foreword of my book. I in there, I refer to him. So they're going to be able, and he's solid. He knows his interconnections in the physical world. If you are struggling with the addiction that you mentioned, like emotional, either addiction, trauma, grief, I would send you to Gabor Mate, G-A-B-O-R, last name M-A-T-E. He's an MD, a Canadian doctor. He's all over the internet. His book, The Myth of Normal, huge bestseller. He is 79 years old, maybe 80 years old. And he's this really wise physician who connects your physical health to your mental, emotional, social, spiritual worlds. And I love that he says, people make addiction bad. I'm not worried about the addiction. The addiction saved you from something really important and worse than the addiction. The addiction was your savior. I don't ask why the addiction. I ask, what is the pain? What's the pain underneath that you're thinking that opioids or alcohol or drugs or whatever it is gambling, retail therapy, scrolling the internet is better than that. And I think we're a world that hasn't really spent enough time teaching people emotional intelligence in order for them to understand how to navigate their hearts. So when they feel disappointment, devastation, grief, loss, trauma, they don't know what to do. And so I'm actually proud of them for finding a way to soothe themselves when they didn't know how to do that. And then when you realize that, you're like, oh, so this is covering something else up that's much worse. Now I'm strong enough. Now I'm old enough. Now I'm resourceful enough. I'm ready to heal that. And then you just don't need the other thing, whatever it is. You can choose it if it's something you enjoy, like a glass of wine or whatever it is. You can choose it, but you don't want to need it. So I would say for the trauma, grief, loss, all of that, I would say Gabor Mate.
Great. Fantastic.
Oh, and David Kessler, too. David Kessler is another resource, grief.com.
If anyone's had traumatic loss of spouse, child, any of that, he has some really powerful groups and online courses.
Yes, yes. Well, so tell us about your book. So give us kind of like an outline and, you know, just a little bit more tips about it.
So I'm going to go through both books. First book is Talk Rx. That is two things: how our inability to communicate makes us physically ill, and if you're somebody who avoids conflict, healthy conflict, and you want to learn how to lean into it, speak when you hold back, or not explode, but do it in a way that's really going to strengthen your relationships, reduce your stress, and make you feel more personal power in the world and deeper connections to others, that's Talk Rx. You'll find that in audiobook. Powered by Me, From Burned Out to Fully Charged at Work and in Life, is really that overview that we did, which is, where are you having a net gain or a net drain of energy on a physical, mental, emotional, social, spiritual level? And once you figure that out, let's demystify burnout. Let's personalize it to you so you know where the net gains and net drains are, where you need to focus. And then let's give you powerful, practical tools to heal. And so that's really what Powered by Me is. It's that, you know, each one of us, we can't do this for each other. We actually need to do it for ourselves. We need to know, for me, my throat constricts and my stomach turns. Do you know how your body talks to you when you get out of your comfort zone? What is it doing? How's it?
I'm sure I get a tightening in my throat. You know, like I used to. I don't anymore. But I did some work, some emotional trauma work on that. But I for sure would, like, just my throat would just tighten up.
Tighten right up. For some people, it's like heart racing, sweating, stomach turning, you know, sinking, a sinking feeling. Some people get headaches. You know, when you start to tune into your body, you also, not all things, you always want to, you know, get a clean bill of health from your doctor, but not all things that are physical have a physical cause. Like my mom, many years ago, I write about this in Talk Rx. My mom had debilitating migraines. So I told you, my parents had an arranged marriage in 1965. They didn't know each other, and they came to a strange country and started having kids. So they barely knew each other. And as they got to know each other, my dad has a temper and expresses himself. My mom gets quiet and culturally thinks, if anything goes wrong with this family, it's my fault. Like, I got to hold the glue of the family together. So she's not speaking up. He's, you know, expressing himself whenever he's upset. And she develops migraines after they do CAT scans and they do all this stuff saying, oh, nothing's wrong with your head. Like, there's no mass in there or anything. She goes to a psychologist and he says, do you think your husband would come in and join us in this meeting? And she's like, sure. So my dad's like, yeah, I mean, I just wanted your mom to feel better. So they're sitting in the meeting and the psychologist says, I think that a combination of your culture has had you stay quiet. You don't speak, so you have to learn to voice. And your husband just blows up whenever something disappoints him or upsets him, and you absorb that. So not only are you absorbing and holding your own, you're then absorbing his anger. And I think that those experiences for you, your inability to communicate and your husband's temper, I think that that's what's causing your migraine. My mom said she walked out of that office, never had another migraine again.
Wow.
And I remember that really affecting me when I was little, saying like, wow, mom, you're really powerful. Like she said, Neha, once I understood that everything physical is not physical, sometimes unresolved things on a mental, emotional, social, and spiritual level show up in your physical body to get your attention. So if somebody's out there listening and they're like, yeah, I mean, I got a clean bill of health medically and physically and all of these things, and I don't know what's going on, what I'd ask you to do is pay some attention. That's talk RX. That's pay some attention to what else might be going on another level that's showing up in your physical body to get your attention.
Yeah, because our body's crying for help.
It is.
And you have to listen to it. It's not always a physical solution for a seemingly physical problem.
But we do have it in traditional medicine. We have a lot of ways we can numb your pain. So we've got a lot of ways where we can make it temporarily go away. But what I like to say is, listen, Mark taught me this. Mark Hyman taught me this. Like, your headache, it's not an Advil deficiency. Like, the Advil's going to get you through the next podcast, through the next meeting, through the next whatever. But that's not why you have a headache. That's a coping mechanism to get you through a deadline or through an event. So you gotta know, on what level are you solving something?
Yeah. And so tell us about your free download. You'd mentioned it earlier, and I can put that in the show notes. If you guys want to go to MyersDetox.com and just type in Neha, and then you'll find the show notes to download it.
Sure. So in Powered by Me, I didn't put it in the book, which is interesting. So I'll give them one that's in the book, and I'll give them one that's the assessment. So an overall assessment, if you want, it's six videos, short videos of me walking you through each of these sections. If you want that, it's intuitiveintelligenceinc.com, so INC at the end, .com/burnout-RX. So burnout-RX is the prescription. And if they want, if you're somebody who's saying like, yeah, I just need to ground myself right now, like I'm feeling uneasy, I don't know how to just kind of recenter myself, you can go to intuitiveintelligenceinc.com/PBM resources, powered by me, PBM resources. That's on page 20 of the book. And it's a website that I created as a toolkit for anybody who needed to get grounded right now. Like, they don't need to read the rest of the book. Like, what they need to do is find a way to kind of ground themselves. And it's where I put a lot of the resources for the book in there. But I'm thinking, if somebody needs to learn soft belly breathing, they need to learn what guided imagery is and have some experiential tools to kind of help guide them. There's a lot more than that on there, but at least it's a way that somebody who might be struggling or feeling anxious or uneasy will at least be able to reground.
Okay, fantastic. Well, thank you so much, Neha, for informing us. That's such a good show. I love that conversation, and so important for people to get tools for burnout, reducing their stress, and you know, adopting all of the things that you talked about in the show today, and you know, improving their skill set around having those uncomfortable conversations.
Well, I am like envisioning a world where we do this one company at a time together, like all of us learning one community at a time. Like, I think it's time now. Like, the world is moving way too fast. And I think we need to, we didn't do it in, you know, school. We didn't do it in our families. Like, now we've got to do it in our companies, because we've got an entire 30% of the workforce is Gen Z by 2030.
Yeah.
And they grew up on digital, you know, devices. And I'm not sure that conflict and real-time communication is their strength. And in order to have our world, I mean, they're going to be taking care of us. And so it's our job, I think, to help get them these tools and for us to learn them as well. So thank you so much for having me.
Yes, thank you. Yeah. And that emotional IQ can be more important than actually your actual IQ when it comes to succeeding on the world. So it's just really
important. Happiness, right?
Yes.
Happiness in your job, in your relationships, ability. I call it like the difference between personal power and positional power. Like, everybody's craving the name on the door, the fancy title, like the whatever it is. But like, personal power is you really having the confidence inside you and the self-trust to navigate change.
Absolutely. Well, Neha, thanks so much for coming on the show. And everyone, thanks so much for joining us for the Myers Detox podcast. And I just love doing these interviews every week, love giving you this information that you can use to up-level your health, your mental health, your happiness, because you do deserve to feel good. So that's why I do this show. So thanks for tuning in.
The Myers Detox Podcast is created and hosted by Wendy Myers. This podcast is for information purposes only. Statements and views expressed on this podcast are not medical advice. This podcast, including Wendy Myers and the producers, disclaim responsibility for any possible adverse effects from the use of information contained herein. Opinions of guests are their own, and this podcast does not endorse or accept responsibility for statements made by guests. This podcast does not make any representations or warranties about guest qualifications or credibility. Individuals on this podcast may have direct or indirect financial interest in products or services referred to herein. If you think you have a medical problem, consult a licensed physician.